Blooper was the first to grasp the truth of Kraski's statement.
"Come on, boys," he said. "Karl was right."
And he turned and followed the Russian. Peebles stood scratching his head, entirely baffled by the puzzling problem, which Throck also was pondering deeply. Presently, the latter turned after Blooper and Kraski.
"Come on, John," he said to Peebles. "I don't understand it, but I guess they're right. They're heading straight for where the sun set last night, and that sure must be west."
His theory tottering, Peebles followed Throck, though he remained unconvinced. The four men, hungry and footsore, had dragged their weary way along the jungle trail toward the west for several hours in vain search for game. Unschooled in junglecraft, they blundered on. There might have been on every hand fierce carnivore or savage warriors, but so dull are the perceptive faculties of civilized man, the most blatant foe might have stalked them unperceived. And so it was that shortly after noon, as they were crossing a small clearing, the zip of an arrow that barely missed Blooper's head brought them to a sudden, terrified halt. With a shrill scream of terror, the Jew crumpled to the ground. Kraski threw his rifle to his shoulder and fired.
"There!" he cried. "Behind those bushes!"
And then another arrow, from another direction, pierced his forearm. Peebles and Throck, beefy and cumbersome, got into action with less celerity than the Russian, but, like him, they showed no indication of fear.
"Down!"
cried Kraski, suiting the action to the word.
"Lie down and let them have it!"
Scarcely had the three men dropped among the long grass when a score of pygmy hunters came into the open, and a volley of arrows whizzed above the prone men, while from a nearby tree two steel-gray eyes looked down upon the ambush. Blooper lay upon his belly with his face buried in his arms, his useless rifle laying at his side, but Kraski, Peebles, and Throck, fighting for their lives, pumped lead into the band of yelling pygmies. Kraski and Peebles each dropped a native with his rifle, and then the foe withdrew into the concealing safety of the surrounding jungle. For a moment there was a cessation of hostilities. Utter silence reigned, and then a voice broke the quiet from the verdure of a nearby forest giant.
"Do not fire until I tell you to," it said in English, "and I will save you."
Blooper raised his head.
"Come quick! Come quick!" he cried. "We will not shoot! Save me! Save me! Won't I give you 5 pounds?
From the tree from which the voice had issued, there came a single, low, long-drawn, whistled note, and then silence for a time. The pygmies, momentarily surprised by the mysterious voice emanating from the foliage of a tree, ceased their activities, but presently, hearing nothing to arouse their fear, they emerged from the cover of the bushes and launched another volley of arrows toward the four men lying among the grasses in the clearing. Simultaneously, the figure of a white giant leaped from the lower branches of a patriarch of the jungle, as a great black-maned lion sprang from the thicket below.
"Oi!"
shrieked Blooper, and again buried his face in his arms. For an instant, the pygmies stood terrified, and then their leader cried,
"It is Tarzan!"
and turned and fled into the jungle.
"Yes, it is Tarzan. Tarzan of the apes!" cried Lord Greystoke. "It is Tarzan and the golden lion!"
But he spoke in the dialect of the pygmies, and the whites understood no word of what he said. Then he turned to them. "The Gomangani have gone," he said. "Get up." The four men crawled to their feet. "Who are you, and what are you doing here?" demanded Tarzan of the apes.